As Karen said, my name's Andy Needham. I'm a senior freelance motion designer based in London. Also a digital artist and educator. I've been working in the industry for quite a long time, and it's always something to learn. So an opportunity like this to kind of do a bit of research around a topic is always welcome. So I've just been spending time kind of, you know, having some fun with volumes in Cinema 4D, but we'll get into that in a minute. If you want to find any of my training, it's mostly on LinkedIn Learning. There's also some of my courses on Grayscale Gorilla Plus, and had a little opportunity to contribute to one of EJ Hassenfratz's courses on School of Motion, all great training resources. And before we get into the presentation, hopefully without any technical difficulties, I can play my reel, and then we'll dive in. So here we go. So I want to talk about creating cloud assets in Cinema 4D, and this is such a broad topic that we're going to start with the very basics. And I have two presentations, so I couldn't fit this all into one. I've got another one on Sunday. So we're going to dive into the first part, which is, as I said, the basics of this. The overview really is what I'm going to be going through. How we get the basic geo in, that could be created in a variety of ways, then how we refine that geo, and also going to be diving quite deep into the volume builder workflow with fields to essentially sculpt out the shape of the clouds. And it's all rendered with volume material, and we're going to use Redshift. Any renderer that can use can render volumes will work, but Redshift is now the standard in Cinema 4D24. So we're going to use it, and it's a great renderer. So I'm not going to go into the science of this, but there are so many different types of clouds. We're going to be focusing on maybe the stratocumulus and the cumulus ones, the ones that are more kind of your fluffy clouds with the flat base and things like that. They're more of a stylistic look to them. But there are so many different types, and they all have different meanings, apparently. I haven't really too far into the science element, but let's talk about maybe creating something similar to this. And I'm going to jump into Cinema 4D, and we're going to see where we get to, because the results are always different as well. So let's just see what happens. All right. So typically, you're going to want to build up your geometry. So, you know, maybe something like a sphere, and we're going to just control or command click and drag and create some duplicates of this, and we want to reshape and resize them so that we get the base form of the cloud. And I'm going to bring this over, maybe make this a little bit bigger. I'm not looking for symmetry as such, something like this. So maybe I want to kind of bring this one over and make it a bit more kind of blobby and kind of just build this out. And obviously doing this quite quickly on the fly, we could then think about the depth of this, because we probably want to render this from multiple angles. So we'd, you know, build out something at the back so it's not like this long kind of weird tube. Essentially, I'm just kind of shaping this and building up a silhouette. And the silhouette can be kind of hard to see. So let's just take all of these and we'll put them into a connect. And then we'll add a material. We'll create a material, drop it on. And you know, shiny reflective material isn't going to help us too much. So I'm going to come into my material settings here. And all I want to do really is just take out the color. I'll take out the reflection. And something something like this helps, but maybe we would just want to make it white. So you kind of get to see, and if we filter off, so we're just seeing the geometry, you kind of get to see this rough shape that we're essentially working with. And you know, that's kind of useful for when you just want to preview it, but not when you want to continue modeling and building this out. So I'm going to, this is one method of working with it. And of course, now we want to maybe think about how do we flatten out the base. So this is definitely a few methods of that as well. I'm going to cover one right now. Thanks to EJ for this one. You just take a melt deformer, and we're going to keep it the same level as hierarchy as the connect object. And it looks a bit strange right now, but if we just take out the strength, and we can art direct this by, let's just turn off geometry only. Now we can see our axis. If we just manipulate the y-axis, you can see now we can kind of really flatten out that base as we'd like it. And so that's one way of doing that. Let's take this away. We could take our connect, we could take it into something like ZBrush. So if we export this using the GoZ workflow here, and I'll just drag it out. Let's just see where we're up to. I'm going to click to edit this, and I'm just going to orient it so I can see my cloud, and we'll zoom out a little bit. So again, another method could be just to press Control and Shift, and we want to click over here, and we'll grab either Clip Curve or Clip Rect or something like that. Control Shift again, and we'll just clip off the bottom there, and then we can even add more detail in ZBrush, sculpt it, send it back into Cinema 4D. Lots of possibilities there. And again, the silhouette, you always get that with ZBrush. You can see exactly what you're forming there. So we could send this back once we're happy with it, but it's just simply a case of simply clicking that, and it will come back into Cinema 4D, and we can then work with it further. So if I hide the original, you can see this is what we got from ZBrush there. We don't necessarily need that right now. And let's just talk about another method as well. So we'll take our connect object and we'll put it into a volume builder. And we're going to use this in the sort of modeling way with the signed different distance field or SDF volume type. And if I drop the voxel size down to about 5, we can start to see a little bit more of the forms. And I'm just going to disable it temporarily because I want to bring in a cube. And we're going to kind of use this as our shape to cut everything out. So if I make it so that, you know, it encompasses the base, and I'll make it a child of the volume builder and enable that, it's actually stuck together with it now. So what we need to do is select our cube, change the mode from union to subtract, and that's kind of given us the result we want. We could, of course, like lower the voxel size further, or to get a nicer, more rounded look, we'll smooth this out. And so, yeah. And we can play with the type, the voxel distance, and the strength of this just to sort of define the look a bit more. So, and again, if at any point, you know, you can then come back in. Let's just see. Let's take off the cube. We could just take this one. I feel like it's not really, it's getting eaten away a little bit. So we could make that a bit bigger. We could add to this, you know, change the shape up a little bit more. And it's all then connected, put into the volume builder, and as long as, again, we make the cube kind of cut it all off, we're going to get something like this. So I don't necessarily need that last one. I'll delete it. Again, it's up to me. I can change my mind at any point. So we've got this cube look. Sorry, we've got this cloud look here. And what we could then do is take this and remesh it, mesh it. So now we've got geometry that we can see with an actual wire mesh. If that's a bit too dense, we can always change the adaptive value, just increase that. And it looks all right, but we also have another tool to adjust the flow. So we can remesh this. This is the Z remesher that's come from ZBrush. And so, yeah, now we're getting somewhere. And so this doesn't have to do all the remeshing calculations and all that. In fact, I'm going to keep it as it is, because what I want to do is first add a bit more additional detail. And I don't want to model it. I don't want to spend time doing that. I'm going to use a deformer. So I'm going to grab a displacer. And I'm going to drop this so that it's at the same level of hierarchy as the remesh. So it could be either way. Doesn't matter. As long as it's the same level of hierarchy, it's going to work. Now, this is looking for a shader, something black and white. So a noise would be something quite good that we can put into here to give ourselves some more details to get some more of a puffy look. But I'm going to change the noise type, and I'm going to right-click here and just open the window, because it can be a little bit difficult to see if you're all the way at the back there. So if I make this a lot bigger, you can now see this noise type. And we'll change this to, let's change it to Voronoi 1. And this is kind of doing what I want it to do, but the it's going the opposite way. So a quick way of swapping this over, we can right-click on the black color, set it to the swap color, and on the white, we will swap the colors around. And now we'll be getting some blobs, but it doesn't look too blobby until we increase the scale. And now we're getting some real nice, you know, features there. And so if I close this down now, and we'll hide that. What I want to do now is, like, I don't want this to keep calculating and calculating in the next step. So I could keep it procedural, but what I'm going to do is drop this into a connect, like so. And I will right-click and current state to object. So that's going to take this, essentially freeze it, turn it into a polygonal mesh. And if we hide this, and let's just turn all of those off, it's exactly the same. But it's just a bit more kind of manageable to work with. We have this same topology. So for a bit of organization, we'll call this one ZBrush. And this one is the original. And this is our cloud base. Let's start to work with this now with volumes. And we'll drop it into a volume builder. So I completely glossed over voxels, voxel types, voxel size, and things like that. So I'm going to address that now so that we're all on the same page. And a voxel is like a 3D pixel. I've got this current setup here. So imagine the sphere is essentially our cloud that we want to put in. And to illustrate this, I'm just using a matrix object set to a fairly sort of large size. And it's in grid mode, and it's expecting an object. So I'll drop in the sphere, and I'll just hide the one that we see there. And imagine that the voxels are like 3D cubes and carry information. In this case, we want them to carry density and things like that. And this is all very well and good. But we're getting, if we look around here, like it's like a stair step, you know? It's not exactly describing the form of that sphere too well. So what we could do is reduce the size of the voxels, and that would then give us way more information and a really high-res look here. And if we come back to our low-res version, this is, imagine the black and white values is the data that we're trying to extract and work with. Well, you know, once we work with a high-res, that pattern becomes way more clearer. There's way more information there, but at the expense of, it's quite hard to work with. You're going to run out of memory potentially. So there's a workflow as well, which we'll get into in the second part, of kind of working more low res and then caching it out and up resing and things like that, just to kind of save you from the time of simulating and stuff. But I just wanted to sort of cover that right now. Let's just dive into our example. And we're going to switch this over from SDF to fog. So this looks very blocky, and that's because our voxel size is too high. So we're going to lower this down, and now we start to see the shape that we input. If we click onto this, we want to kind of linearize the values so we can work with this a bit more. And so from the outside to the inside, 0 to 1, we can play with the fall off, like so, or you can just check on the maximum voxel fall off that we have at the bottom here, and that's kind of like smoothing it out. It's giving us a bit more of a manageable kind of volume to work with. So at this point, now you could render it, and it wouldn't look that great. So the typical workflow would be to maybe grab a random field or a shader field, something that has a pattern to it. Let's just grab a random field for now, drop it in. And what we're seeing is just this box here. And that's not exactly useful at all. We want to set the mode to objects below. And now we see that noise pattern. If we multiply this, we're saying take the black values and cut out from this volume and the white ones and add to it. Okay, that's one field. Maybe we add another one and we get that same box again. And we have to, it's a bit laborious going through doing all this. I don't want to do that. I want to save time and work a bit smarter. So I'm going to delete these. Oh, not all of it, just the fields. Excuse me. And I'm going to add a group field. So this is a folder that can contain all kinds of different fields. And we have way more benefits as well, like being able to blend the fields that we put in, treat it like a kind of Photoshop layer almost. So we're going to, and this is, I've got a shout out to Tim Clapham for reminding me about this this technique as well. So we're going to put our group field in. We'll set that to objects below and multiply. And it's all got a little bit soft. And in fact, we don't even need to have this in. The volume builder works in a couple of ways where we can have children. We can also have links as well. So it's outside of the volume builder, but it still works as a link. So, you know, why not? We'll do it that way. We can keep ourselves a bit more organized if we ever want to find that group field. We don't have to dive into too many things. So from the group field, we have this interface where we have all of the fields available to us. I'm going to start working with a shader field. I feel like I've got a little bit more control over that. So, and it's set to multiply within the volume build, but there's no information here. So we're just multiplying by 0. That's why it's disappeared. So we're going to change this to noise, and now we get our volume back. So we're going to come in here and choose a noise, and there's so many. If you can't, you can also click here to get a little preview of them. But I found that the Nutrius one is a little bit more kind of cloud-like, especially if we increase the scale and then maybe, you know, set this away from the default random seed. So this is okay. We could, of course, adjust our low clip, high clip, and cut it out, but we start to eat away a little bit more. And recently I found, like, just by taking another instance of a shader field, we'll set that to multiply within the group field and then give that a noise. So it's now acting on the layer below. And we're going to change that to the same type of noise and increase the scale quite a bit, something similar. You know, play around with our random seed a bit. And just kind of, it's going to sort of complement the other one in a nice way. So we can bring this in. We can then, again, maybe that's not filled in enough for us. So again, we'll just come in, add other fields. Let's add one more. Maybe set this to min. And we can then get some more fine details in with another noise. A nice type for that is something like FBM. And if I increase the scale, scale to like 500. Okay, that's doing something. Of course, we can try and take all our individual fields. Like I said, if we're not happy, you can blend, play with the opacity. Maybe bring this one, dial it back a bit, you know. And we're starting to get areas of the volume that are more dense than others. So this is going to give us different values when we start to texture it. So another way of, if we want to plump this up a little bit, is to go back to the volume builder and start to maybe play with those voxel values even further. So we have reshape filters, a whole list of them here. So we could multiply this, and you'll start to see that kind of fill in a bit better. Okay? And I have to stress that it's a balancing act between this, what you do in the material, what you do with your lighting, what you do with the render settings. It's all kind of tweaks, lots of small tweaks to refine. So this is kind of broadly like what we want to do. Maybe we, you know, you want to smooth all that out, but that's a bit too much. Change one of the types to one of the less intense ones, or you could reduce the voxel distance and that would make it less blurry, or again, play with the strength. Lots of options there. I think I'm going to take off the smooth for now and just see what I've got, because we want to sort of start to see something a bit more pretty on screen than this gray cloud. So I'm going to start, because we're already in Redshift, I'm going to create one of the sun and sky rigs. And this is a lovely new mode, PRG Clear Sky. If we come over to Redshift and fire up the render view, oh, that's fun. Maybe I'll just change this setting over. Good. I'm glad that solved it. All right. So, So we can look at the sky. Let's just look at the sky for a minute. So, this is a really nice, you know, model. We have our intensity. We can increase the turbidity, which is a bit like the haziness. We can blur the horizon. We can even adjust the height of the horizon, like so. Then there's some color adjustments we can do. And I find like you have to have a real fine touch with this, because just by knocking it back a bit, it goes a bit too blue and a bit too maybe like a alien sky or something. So small values like 0.2 or minus 0.2 just to get that real blue sky can help. And also the position of the sun. So we can adjust that here in the coordinates. At the moment, this is pointing at a 45-degree angle, so we could start to rotate this round, and we'll find our sun. And it's kind of there now. Let's bring it down. There it is, and you can kind of create a sunset, get a nice-looking result. Imagine the cloud there, all backlit. Could be quite lovely. Maybe we'll try it. It's a positive value because I've raised the horizon height. So let's just keep that as it is for now. It's looking quite nice. So onto the volume material. We don't need these anymore, so I'm going to clear those out. So I'm going to add a volume material, and I'll apply it to our volume builder. Nothing's going to happen because we haven't specified the channel. We're getting most of it right. We've got, you know, a light in our scene. The light is the sunlight. In the details, if we come over to contribution, it's contributing to the volume. That's really important. If it didn't have any volume contribution, again, we wouldn't see the light, the volume at all. But we have this now volume material, and it's connected up in the right way. It has to be connected to the volume output. But we don't have anything to put into our scatter channel. You can come into your presets and find the volume builder that we have here. And as soon as we do that, you can now see that we have this very wispy looking volume. Another thing that you may not know is you could just, this is just taking the name of this. So if this material was set up with like density in there, we could just change the name to density and it's going to go away. But if we just find it here, density, it's back. Okay, so just another thing to point out. I think I'm gonna close down the node editor and tend to work in the attribute manager just so we can see a bit more on screen at the same time. So now we wanna start working here in this material. So the key things to balance are your scatter coefficient and the absorption. And so we could increase this. And again, I don't think we've got enough density here. So maybe even bumping this up a bit more might help. You could also remap the ranges as well. So we take our 0 to 1 and then really bump it up. So like, you know, something like so, okay? This really gives us that more dense looking cloud. You could do it within the material as well. Let's actually try that just so you can see it. I'll turn off the range map. If we come over to the RS volume in the advanced, we can do it here. Okay, so we're essentially remapping those values. I don't mind either way. I'll just, you know, I guess you just have to keep track of what you've been changing, you know, in just so you know what's going on. So we'll set that to like so. Now, this is probably absorbing a bit too much, so 0.6. And we're starting to see this cloud. Oh, it's looking kind of nice. And typically, you know, you would then go into your render settings in the advanced tab. And let's just change this over. The brute force can help if it starts to flicker. But the next thing to look at is the globals tab and the actual volume trace depths. And this is where you're going to add more light and get more light scattering around the volume. So if we just increase that by 1, we're starting to see more light in here. It's not looking that great. I think also another setting to play with, especially with clouds, is I'm looking for anisotropy. And I want to make that more of like a positive value. You see what happened to, like, we get this sort of haloing effect where the light is continuing to travel forwards. Whereas if it's in a negative direction, it's going to then travel back towards the light source that is pointing at it. So you can see that kind of here, and it looks a bit flat and dull. So let's just undo that point. Something like so. So our volumes, trace depths now, 12, that's quite a lot. So if I increase this value, then we're going to get like a white looking cloud. Probably not going to look like this on a day like this. So the sky color and the environment is important as well. I would probably change my sky to, let's just put the sun back and maybe come back here to color correction. Get a nice more blue sky. Something like so. You know, so many little tweaks and changes. But you know, that feels like it fits a bit better. But there's something here at the great expense of render time, you know, by adding your volume trace depths. So if we step that back down to 1, it doesn't look too great. So we could come into the material and cheat a little bit, especially if we're being a bit artistic about it. So it's all a bit of a cheat. So let's just come in here and maybe add some density into the emission. But now we've got this fire cloud. I want to change the emission mode to color ramp. And now we're kind of filling in a bit of those darker areas. Okay, so we just tend to maybe just boost it a little bit. Another thing we could do is reduce our shadow density scale. And that's going to kind of cheat the trace depths. It's a bit of a cheat, but it renders so much faster. You know, not technically right maybe, but it kind of looks all right. I think before we move on from the material, I want to talk about the tinting as well, because obviously you could tint this, you can make this cloud any color you want. The other thing to talk about here is the gradient below, where we're talking about on the left with the black value, that is the least dense parts of the volume, and then the white is the most dense. So again, you could really bump it up by bringing these values closer together. Or you could say, let's just remove this for now. Those darker values there, we could say, oh, you know what? I want to take those and kind of take those values and maybe brighten them a bit. you know, and do something with it like that. So certainly plenty of options. But once you're happy, you know, then set this up. And I guess the next thing to do would be to put this into a scene. How do you export this and work with it further? And that is with exporting it as a VDB. Before we do that, I think I'm going to just jump over to this end state that I've got here, because I just wanted to point out another potential workflow. So with this one, I really wasn't too concerned about getting that flat base and all that kind of stuff. I just wanted to build out a shape, chuck it in the volume builder. You can see I've got my displacer on here. And I need to, and then what I did was I'll enable the group field. And now what I'm using is a linear field to create that flat base. So let's put the lights on again so we can see it a bit better. So you can see the linear field now controls a lot of this. So if I was kind of happy with the cloud at this state, I could export this as a VDB. Maybe I want a little puff like this. That's another one. You know, and another little bit here, I can do that as well. So we can start to create some building blocks that we can export. So the process of that, say we hadn't named our volume builder, we'll call it density, because typically the grids that come in as VDBs, they're expecting it to be called density. So we'll play nice, we'll work alongside that. We could then export this. So we'll come over to our export. As long as it's selected, actually, I'm going to click on the gear, because this is another thing to note. So with our export settings here, it says selected only. So we make sure that we have something selected here. We don't want animation on. There's no animation in this one. So I'll choose OK. And it's going to ask me where I want to save this. I'll just choose here. And in a new scene, in fact, I'm going to copy this material. And I'm going to paste it. It's great that you can copy and paste between documents. You can not just do materials. We could do render settings as well. So I can right-click and copy this. Come in. I got that all set up nice. I don't want to spend more time changing it. You could also save it as a preset, but you know, here's just another way. So now we can bring in a volume. So we use the RS volume. Let's open this up. We'll find the one that we just exported. And it comes in like so. You can see that the channel is density at the bottom there. But if you can't see anything at all, we can just change our preview from basically nothing to points. And then we can adjust the points to display and the threshold. Or, you know, keep it off. It's up to you. Because when you apply the material, and don't forget your lights as well. Let's do that. We can then open up the render view. And who was paying attention? The material is not called density. It was called volume builder. So what I want to do is change this to, say, density. And check that that one is correct. Do we see a cloud? We do. OK. So I think I'll just frame this up a little bit. So we have our cloud there. Looks like I lost that channel. So then you can have fun building other clouds. So you can take another one. We could rotate this. And form something entirely different. You know, we can really sort of compose this how we want. All those other different parts. Let me show you. I took a whole load of different parts and then just arranged them. And you know, this was quite fun to put together. Before I have to go, I want to say as well, the whole thing can continue again and again and again. Right? If we take our volume Let's see, the one that we just made. And we bring it into C4D like so. Just not as a RS volume, but just as a volume set. So you'd probably come into the volume loader like this and do that. We can see it in the viewport, and that's really important because that kind of data is available to us. So we can put this in a volume builder. We can change this to fog, drop the voxels down, and find some fields, copy that, bring it in, put it in like this, multiply, and it needs to be objects below, and go around again, you know? You can then export that, make other different things. If you wanted to refine and refine and refine, of course you can. So that was a lot. And that was just the basics. I don't know. There's a lot more to come in part two, which will be on Sunday. So I wanted to just get the idea of these building blocks across, just generating those smaller volumes you can then export as the VDB, bring them back in, adjust, and build up a library of assets. And these are very kind of simple-looking clouds, very kind of stylized clouds. But again, just on this laptop that I have here, the rendering difference between this cloud and this cloud is quite significant. The only difference was the material settings in one on the left and the volume trace steps using just a very balanced material on the right. So lots of things to consider and take away. So here's some key elements, really, just those the geometry that goes in, and the, you know, working with volumes, making sure to use the group field just to save your sanity, but also to have the ability to manipulate it with sliders and things like that. And then, yeah, make sure you got your light material and a renderer that's capable of rendering volumes, such as Redshift. So in part two, I'll be talking about some of this stuff. Really excited to dive into capsules and Pyro to try and automate some of that geometry creation process and build on this even further. Thank you so much for your attention. Really appreciate it. Thank you to Maxon for having me out. And have a great show, everybody. All right. See you soon.